when we were developing and testing this feature, we literally have colleagues simulating the situation, walking with an unlocked phone, and colleagues coming up from behind and snatching the phone and run away. And there are different scenarios that we learn from our market research, and then we try to act it out and simulate it in a lab setting.
Welcome to the Made by Google podcast, where we meet the people who work on the Google products you love. Here's your host, Rachid Finch.
We just launched something new in Android. It's called Theft Detection Lock, which keeps your data safe if someone snatches your phone. To learn more, we're talking to Sandra Guo, a product manager on the platform security and privacy team.
This is the Made by Google podcast.
Sandra, have you ever had your phone stolen? And did that make some sort of lasting impression on you?
I have lost many phones, and I'm not sure if it was stolen. It could have been. Or did I misplace it? I never quite know for sure. And when it happened, it was always a shock. It was like, oh, did I misplace it? And usually I go through the steps of trying to locate it. This also goes back to the time even before self-location was available. And I go through it. And in the most recent cases, I did find my device, and I was able to locate the device in a parking lot. And then heard about the more recent phone snatching cases in cities like London, in countries like Brazil. It made me very worried that if I were in that situation, what would I do?
So hopefully we have something for our fellow Android users. But let's start at the beginning. You're a product manager. You work on platform security and privacy, and most recently, phone theft protection that recently launched, and also the new feature drop for our fellow Pixel users. But let's rewind the clock a little bit. You've been with Google for 14 years, which is an amazing tenure. Have you always been working on Android while you were at Google?
No, I haven't always been working on Android, but I have always worked in security. I actually studied security as my specialty when I was in college. Then I interned on the security team at Google. So I joined the data protection team afterward. And I worked in cloud security and worked in privacy and most recently Android privacy and security. So my entire career has been in protecting users' security and privacy.
So there is some sort of a transition going from, let's say, traditional cybersecurity into which I guess you could say is more physical security now in a way.
Yes, exactly. It makes quite an impact on me to think about my work directly impact the daily lives of the user in a very direct way. It's not theoretical. It's not cyber. It's not remote. It's actually physical protection of a physical device and the data that it holds.
So let's start with that problem, phone theft. I imagine if you're going to design a feature to prevent issues when something like that occurs, you're probably going to do research and see some sort of statistics on, you know, how often does this happen? What are the kind of numbers you can share there?
The numbers is kind of horrendous. When we started researching this, we initially heard this from Brazil. And the numbers that we found there was every hour, close to 100 cell phones were robbed or stolen. And this number was in 2021, and it was only getting worse with every year passed.
So if I were to leave my phone in a bar, for example, for a thief to actually extract data from it, the thief would need maybe my PIN code on my phone, or it would need sort of the ability to replicate my face maybe, or a fingerprint. So let's talk about theft detection lock, which is new. What kind of scenario did you have in mind where it would actually help against a thief being able to get stuff from my phone?
Yeah, I think the foundation assumption that we have is if a phone has properly set up PIN or decent quality of biometric sensors, if it's properly configured, it is safe when it's in a locked state. However, the exploit that we have seen increasing globally is more targeting unlocked devices. So I give you a very common scenario that we've pieced together through user research. In a metropolitan area, let's say London, a user is walking around with navigation on the phone. And he's like, you know, let me see, where is the Westminster Abbey? I want to go look at it. And walking around with the phone running navigation. And an attacker on a motorpad drives by, just grab the phone from the user's hand and motorpads away. The phone is in an unlocked state. Now what do you do? And with access to an unlocked device, the attacker can get into all sorts of sensitive surfaces. He can go in there to reset your bank password. and then from there transfer money.
Exactly, because when I'm walking through London, I'm using navigation and someone snatches my phone, they would just swipe away the navigation app. And then all the apps are, you know, they can make a phone call, they could open my inbox, all these kind of things are possible, right?
Exactly. So what we heard is that when the thief swipes the phone on lock state, that the immediate thing the thief does is try to do things like turning on the camera to try to keep the phone from automatically locking itself.
Right.
Up until this point, as long as the phone is in use, it stays unlocked. And then the attacker would moped to a safe hiding spot. And now he has time to exploit information on the phone. And he may even be able to disable the Find My Device setting. Then even if the user get to a portal to try to remotely lock or wipe the phone is disconnected. And then from there, the thief can reset bank password, go to the photo albums to see are there photos of credit cards and passports. I have all of my passports in my photos album, which is terrible. Identity theft, steal bank information, see what saved password that user have in the password manager and go all into all those third-party services to buy stuff. Well, you even heard like thieves buy things on Amazon and deliver to addresses that they can go pick up. Order food delivery, which is ridiculous.
Really?
Yeah. This showcases the kind of widespread exploit that's available once a thief has an unlocked device.
So let's talk about the solution now, because in Android, there's a new feature called Theft Detection Lock. How does Theft Detection Lock help in that scenario?
Yeah. So we really have to help the user to lock down the device before the thief gets too far from exploiting the data on the phone. So how fast is fast? We realize that if we make it automatic, it can be immediate. Like even the phone is taken away from the user, if we're able to detect that, then we can just lock screen. And we know that lock screen is in a safe state. When that happens, the information is safe. So that's why we looked at different ways to try to detect when a device is taken away from the user, and that self-detection lock feature came to be. We talked with our activity recognition team at Android, that same team that developed the car crash detection for detection. We brainstormed ideas. We're like, yeah, there should be signals that we can analyze to model the behavior when a phone is snatched away from the user. And then we use AI to automate that, to make it really pretty accurate. To say like, here are the phone snatch scenario and this is behavior of various sensors on device, and we use AI to build a model for that, and then we use that to predict the next time similar activity to happen and whether it's a snatch or not.
So what kind of sensors are you looking at in order for the AI to understand what is a theft situation?
We start with a motion sensor on device to try to detect the jerking motion when a phone is snatched away. And then there are additional sensors on device that we use to confirm the assumption that was it a snatch or was it just someone clicking a phone into its holder or, you know, drop a phone on the ground.
So let me get this right. I'm walking on the streets. I'm using navigation. Someone rips the phone out of my hand. And then we have AI looking at all sorts of sensors on my phone to see if that motion was sort of someone, you know, grabbing that phone out of my hand. Maybe they're running away with it. It would detect that and say, this is suspicious, and it will, as a preventative measure, lock my phone. And then you also had to build that in such a way that I guess pretty certain that it is a theft scenario. Because as you mentioned, if you get it wrong most of the time, people will, maybe someone's dancing and then suddenly, you know, it locks itself and people will turn the feature off. So you have to prevent that as well.
There is an upshot of this. That is, because it's motion-based, usually when it fires, even if it's a false positive, and I would say that most of the triggering would be false positive. Otherwise, we live in a terrible, terrible world. I just want to caveat that. But because it's motion-based, when it fires, usually it corresponds to a natural break in a user's flow. It shouldn't be that interruptive. The user may not even notice it because average user lock and unlocks their devices like over 100 times every day. So we try to introduce friction. We'll try to introduce friction in a way that's, you know, innocuous.
So it might be locking when I was putting my phone in my pocket anyway.
Shouldn't matter. If a phone drop on the ground, it locks, right? It shouldn't be a big deal.
Yeah, because you mentioned some other features, and I think it's important to highlight how Android can help before theft, during theft, and also after theft. So that's sort of recovery options after a phone was stolen. So could we walk through all three of those? Maybe start with before theft then. What kind of protections do we have there in place for Android users?
Before theft, we actually thought about that. The best way to prevent theft is to just lower the incentive of theft so the thief doesn't think it's worthwhile to steal our phone. And how do we do that? We already have this feature called factory reset protection. What it does is if someone resets the device without the proper credential of the previous account that was already set up on the device, then the device cannot be reset. If it cannot be reset, it cannot be resold because nobody's going to buy a phone with someone else's account on it. So that's like first step, right? We cut down the incentive. And once a theft scenario is happening, let me actually walk you through the journey of the victim. I was telling you that this person walking around London got his phone snatched. And immediately at that moment, before the user is able to react, the phone will try to lock itself, will try to detect, is there a snatch motion that just occurred? If it did, let me lock myself. That is automatic. But what if the thief takes the phone in a very non-conventional way, like slowly, right? And then walk away. It may not fire. So the user still has to react quickly to make sure the phone gets locked. And when that happens, we know that time is key. We have Find My Device portal already. The user can log in with your Google account to lock your device, wipe your device, or locate your device. So those are solutions that are existing. But when we research why users are not using it quickly in the theft scenario, we very quickly discover that, first of all, the user is in shock. And also, many users don't walk around with their laptops. They only have a phone.
Yeah.
Now they have to go borrow a device, maybe a friend, maybe a family, maybe a bartender's device. And you borrow the device, and now you have to enter your Google account credential to log into the Find My Device portal.
Right.
That's where the friction is. Without the assistance of a password manager, many users can't recall their Google account credentials off the back of their head. When they're in a panicking situation, that they just got robbed and the phone just got stolen. And usually it takes several tries and they may have to go through account recovery in order to get back their credentials. All of this is before they're able to react and remediate the fact their device is lost and try to lock that device down. It takes too long before this whole recovery resolve. And that's where remote lock came to be. You go to android.com/lock. And all you have to do is to enter the verified phone number. Maybe a simple security challenge if you choose to set one up. But those are information that's very, very easy for the user to remember and input. And you just click on secure. You can do this within minutes of the device go missing to remotely lock screen of the device. And it will buy you time to explore how to get back your credentials so you can log into Find My Device portal to do more advanced remediation. I want to stress that Find My Device portal is still the recommended place for users to go to locate, to wipe, to do any sort of advanced remediation for their missing devices. But remote lock gives user an option to react quickly to lock down the phone while they carry on those more advanced remediations because time is essence here. So where are we in the victim's journey? If the phone is taken, self-detection lock may or may not have fired. The user run to a bartender, input his verified phone number in the android.com/lock, remotely logging off the device. Right? Now he can go maybe locate, maybe wipe the device if he's certain the device is gone. Another one of the deterrents that we built in is the offline device lock. So what that does is, again, it's based on a typical attacking behavior that we've learned from thieves, that when they get a hold of an unlocked device, they actually take it offline. The user get to, you know, remote lock, get to Find My Device. They're not able to reach the phone because the phone's offline.
Right.
And now the thief has all the time in the world to explore the contents of the phone. So that's why we created offline device lock.
Is that new in Android as well?
It is. It's part of the protection suite. So the idea here is the feature will detect when a device goes offline, becomes offline for a prolonged period of time. And when that happens, it will lock screen. It introduces a very simple friction to limit the amount of time after the device becomes offline, the time window that someone has to explore its content before having to authenticate again.
I imagine maybe thieves listening right now thinking, oh, an Android phone is maybe not worth it to steal it because it's going to lock itself anyway when I try and grab it when I'm on my moped, right?
Exactly. And then Android phones is too smart. The main goal, right, for building in all of these protections is to make it so difficult for an unauthorized person to take advantage, exploit a device that, you know, the thieves leave it alone.
Now, Sandra, going back to theft detection lock, there is one question I've been dying to ask you, and it's this. How do you test, or in Google language, how do you dog food theft, and how do you train that system to learn these scenarios?
You know, Android building becomes a very dangerous place when we dog food this feature. We actually literally have colleagues, when we were developing and testing this feature, we literally have colleagues, you know, simulating the situation, walking with an unlocked phone, and colleagues coming up from behind and snatching the phone and run away. And there are different scenarios that we learn from our market research, and then we try to act it out and simulate it in a lab setting.
You might be pinging colleagues like, hey, does anyone have a moped because we need it for testing?
Oh, yes. There's cars, there's a moped, there's just good old-fashioned running. There's quite a number of scenarios that we've tested. So, you know, in the office, and we see like, you know, let's try this outside. Let's go outside for this. And then we open it up for what we call dog food within the company. And we actually turn it on by default for everybody in the Android security org at one point, and to see whether it introduces too much friction, whether user can live with, and how accurate it is. And we have lots of security-minded folks in the team that give us many valuable feedbacks, also many valuable complaints that we've made improvements on. And then after that, we also did a beta pilot program in the real world in Brazil. Over the summer, we launched the three features to all users in Brazil, Google for Brazil, back in June, and the features were available to the public in August. We got like real world test by users that live in a country that concerned about theft and live with this feature and try this feature. And we got positive feedback from the market, and we got very positive results as well. And we're able to really observe what this feature is like in the wild, how often users engage with these features, and what are the patterns that user interact with this feature, and any improvement that we can make and that we made before bringing this feature to the rest of the world.
Well, those are three amazing new features in Android. Just, Sandra, quickly, anyone who now has theft protection features in their hands, where do they go to turn them on?
Yes, it's very easy to find. You go to Settings, Google, Theft Protection, and all three features are there for you to enable.
Well, Sandra, thank you so much for introducing these new features to us on the Made by Google podcast. And let the world know, and especially the thieves among them, better not steal an Android phone, because it is definitely not worth it.
That's correct. Thank you, Rachid.
Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you for listening to the Made by Google podcast. Don't miss out on new episodes. Subscribe now wherever you get your podcasts to be the first to listen.